Ahoy, hello dear listeners, welcome to another podcast, and I would like to also welcome here my today's guest, Mr. Michael G. Maurer, an American living in the Czech Republic. Hi, Michael.
Hello, nice to meet everybody.
I'm not sure if you are aware of one phenomenon that kind of happened in the 90s in the Czech Republic, and that's that pretty much all the families were watching Dallas in TV.
Yeah, of course.
And I was quite happy to find out that you have been actually growing in Texas, very nearby to the famous TV series place South Fork. So I have to ask you, have you ever been there?
Yeah. It's a lot closer than you think. Just to pull it back a little bit, my first trip overseas was to London, to England. It was right after the famous cliffhanger of Who Shot JR. And we went to London that summer, and as soon as we said we were from Dallas, everybody wanted to know, did we know Who Shot JR? And I didn't know what they were talking about because I really wasn't old enough to watch that show. I knew about it. But it was really kind of annoying for the first couple of years that everywhere in the world we went, people would ask us about that TV show. The ranch that's so famous, the South Fork Ranch, that's actually just outside the city limits of the town I grew up in, Plano, Texas. And that's where we had our graduation party. We had it there's a giant barn that they built for these kind of occasions. And yeah, that's where we had our dance and our big celebration after the graduation from high school. So yeah, we all know the ranch.
Once that you went to the university, you moved to LA, right? To study there in the film industry or to study there film production, or what exactly was it?
So I had already started making little videos all through high school whenever we had any kind of an assignment. And so basically at that point I realized, well, if I really want to be involved in this industry and maybe if I want to be an actor one day, I should go to film school. USC was a great choice. It's a very famous film school. This is where George Lucas went to school and Robert Zemeckis and John Singleton, who wrote Boys in the Hood and, you know, really became a very iconic filmmaker for the African-American community. It was a great school. It was a great place to be.
Was it during this time that you kind of got the idea that you would like to see a bit more of the world and travel around Europe?
There's a little backstory to that. I was actually dating right after 9/11. So this is September 11, 2001. They made a big push to get people to go to New York, like, please come to New York. So I had friends in New York. I worked for a man who had his big salon was in New York. So I'd worked for him for a few years. So I made a trip to New York right after 9/11. And on the flight back, I started talking to one of the flight attendants. She and I started dating for a couple of months. And I had this fabulous trip planned with her. We were going to fly to Italy, spend 3 weeks together. I had rented a car and rail passes and all this kind of stuff. And the night before we should leave, she flew down to Los Angeles to say she wasn't going to go. So I took this like 3 week trip by myself and I had a fabulous time. So when I came back from that, I said, okay, this isn't a bad way to go. And then a couple of years later, I had an opportunity to do it again because I had been trying desperately for many, many years to get into the film industry. I wasn't working in the film business. I was working in a Beverly Hills hair salon for one of the most famous men in America for coloring hair. I mean, he's the man who made Kim Basinger blonde and he made Susan Sarandon a redhead. I mean, and I got to know these people. That was this incredible list of famous and powerful people who would come into this salon in Beverly Hills, spend a few hours every few weeks or every few months. It's a really long list and I won't bore you with all the details right now, but I kept trying through those connections to get into the film industry and I couldn't make it work. And there's a story behind that. After one last desperate try, I actually joked with friends of mine, like, if I don't get this job, I quit. I'm out of the game. I'm not going to do it anymore. I'm just going to go to Europe. And I got the phone call like on a Tuesday saying, Michael, we're really sorry. We really looked at you and we really looked at this other guy and we're going to go with him. And the next day I got hit by a car on my bicycle, cracked my shoulder. And I was laying in the hospital thinking, okay, in Los Angeles, when something like that happens, you know, you're going to get some money. I mean, it's just what happens. Lawyers get involved and settlements are made. And I had no idea how much money I was going to get. All I knew was like, this wasn't my fault. So I ended up with about $35,000 in cash with, what do you want to do with that? So most of my friends said you should buy a better place or get a new car. And my father said you should put the money in investments. You should, you know, buy some stocks and put that money to work. And I said, no, I'm going to go to Europe for 6 months. It was what I did. I spent all of it in 6 months and a little bit more. I had to borrow some money from my dad to finish the trip at the end. I made it down to Rome. My sister flew into Rome. From there, I went all the way out to Budapest, which wasn't on the list. I had not planned to go to Budapest. And Budapest was fantastic in 1998. It was still rough. It was very run down. It was wide open. It was wild. So I had gone to Budapest. I said, okay, I'll go there for a day and I'll bicycle back up the Danube. And I ended up staying for almost a week. It's just one of those things that I was traveling alone. So with a little extra time, I was able to change my route. So I had originally not planned on going into Slovakia or the Czech Republic. And I wasn't. And I really was sticking to that plan. And I was staying at youth hostels. This was all youth hostels. I had this list of the 25 most fun youth hostels in Europe. So I was trying to hit every one of them. And one night in Budapest, somebody at the hostel said, hey, the Gypsy Kings are playing tonight. And I said, well, geez, let's go. I'll buy tickets. Come on, come with me. I've got lots of money. So I took a couple people from the hostel. We all went to the Gypsy Kings. And while we were standing in line for the Gypsy Kings concert, I noticed a poster advertising an upcoming Ozzy Osbourne concert. Like, oh, Ozzy's on tour. And there, the second or third band under Ozzy's name was a Los Angeles rock band that I was friends with, Coal Chamber. And I met up with the band in Frankfurt. I surprised them. I came, walked into the club. They had just finished. I got there late. And I said, hey, guys. And they, oh, my God, Michael, what are you doing here? We hadn't seen each other in a couple of years. And they said, okay, look, we're going to Prague tomorrow. We got to rejoin Ozzy. We got a huge concert in Prague. Come with us. And I got sick. I was so ill. We had just come back from Turkey, and I was so sick to my stomach. And I couldn't move for like 2 days. So I didn't go to Prague. I could have come to Prague in 1998 with Ozzy Osbourne and Coal Chamber and just said, wow, what an introduction to the city. But I was sick in bed.
Do you remember, did you have any idea about the Czech Republic at the time?
Everybody said, you've got to go to the Czech Republic. You've got to go. There was all of these famous youth hostels, party places in Prague in 98. They were sort of top of the list. And I just couldn't figure out a way. But everybody coming, everywhere I went in this hostel network, they all talked about the Czech Republic and how great it was and you should go and the beer and how cheap it was. So during that little bicycle trip along the Danube, I saw a pub and they had a sign advertising Budvar, you know, and I thought, okay, that's one of those Czech beers. I'll stop right there. So I had my first ever Czech beer on the side of the Danube River, somewhere in the middle of Hungary. It was good, but it wasn't a press ride.
It was quite an extraordinary way how you actually got to the Czech Republic, right?
It is. I mean, I finished that whole bicycle trip. Like I said, it was 6 months. I think I visited 17, 18 countries. I don't know. I mean, I finished in London. So I packed up and came back to Los Angeles. It was a couple of weeks after I got back that a group of my film school fellows called and said, hey, we're putting together a little low budget movie. So I started working they called me the assistant director, but that basically meant I was carrying gear and, you know, moving lights and packing the truck. And we worked horrible long hours. But this little low budget movie called The Trouble with Lou, it went to a film festival called Slam Dance, which is in Sundance at the same time. But Sundance is all these, you know, $3 to $5 million movies. And Slam Dance was all of these 0.5 to 0.7 million dollar movies. But we had such a great time at Slam Dance. We won an award. So having at least one thing on my resume and something that won an award was enough to get you your next job and your next job and your next job. I was lucky and I got asked to help out on the additional photography for the first Spider-Man film. So they had already filmed everything, but they put it all together and say, okay, we've got this problem and this problem and this problem. And one of the big problems was the big fight sequence at the end of the film, that the lead stuntman had broken his leg badly the first day. So they had to cancel shooting that entire sequence. So we shot it. We shot that entire big fight at the end of the movie between the Green Goblin. They needed to add a little action in the middle of the movie. So they built a building across the street from Sony. And that was the burning building sequence, which we helped film. when the spider bites Peter Parker's hand, I shot that shot. I directed that shot. There's one part of that first Spider-Man film where you actually see my ass crossing the screen. I was so excited. We filmed it 25 different ways. Me walking this way, me walking that way, me not walking at all. And when I finally saw the film, there it is. For less than 1 second, that's my ass crossing the screen in Spider-Man. Yeah, I made it. So after that film finished, everyone I was working with was surprised. You know, they liked what I did and they liked my work, but I needed to be, some people were going on to working on underwater things and I wasn't certified to scuba dive. So I went to Bali for 5 days to learn to scuba dive. And the first afternoon, you know, there's a bar on Kuta Beach and I walked in and there was two very, very pretty girls sitting side by side, and I started chatting with them and they didn't speak English and they looked quite angry at me, and I tried to buy them a drink. And I remember this Belgian guy came over and said, "Oh, don't waste your time. Those girls, they're really mean." I said, "Well, I don't think, let's give it a try. You know, if you alone and me alone, this isn't going to happen, but maybe if we team up on this thing." I don't remember that guy's name, but he really helped push it forward. So those two girls, one of them is my wife, Markéta, and the other one is my sister-in-law, Teresa. We went out every night, and it really turned out quite nicely. They left a day earlier than I did. I left the next day, and I didn't think I was going to see them again. I mean, we exchanged phone numbers and email addresses, but a few weeks, maybe 2.5 weeks after we left Bali, that was the terrible terrorist bombing in Kuta Beach. This was these Islamic terrorists, unfortunately, they blew up two bars, one of which we had spent a whole night dancing at. I mean, these were really the two most famous places to be in Kuta Beach. And 260 some odd Australians were killed. After that bombing happened and the news came to us in Los Angeles, I remember I wrote a letter to my scuba diving instructor and I started communicating with Markéta. I immediately wrote her an email saying, "Did you hear what happened?" And of course she had. And we started emailing back and forth. And that's really what led to the relationship growing. She decided to come out just after the new year in 2003. I was working on a movie called Legally Blonde 2. I invited Markéta to come out. She flew out. Her bag, or her backpack, unfortunately, went to India. And that happened to be my birthday the next day. So we were all going out. I was going to introduce her to all my friends. And she didn't have anything to wear. So I went to the costume designers on Legally Blonde 2 and said, "Can I please borrow a few things?" So my wife was actually wearing Reese Witherspoon's wardrobe. It's a little tight because Reese is pretty tall. But that's the film. That's a great example of the film industry. Everybody tries to help each other out. So my boss gave me extra time off because he knew this girl had flown all the way from the middle of Europe. I remember now my boss, George Paras, had actually been an assistant director in Prague. So he knew the Czech Republic. He made XXX. He knew how beautiful the girls were and how strong they can be. And he said, "Look, if this girl flew halfway around the world to meet you, you better spend time with her. So take 3 days off." And he allowed her to come to Salt Lake City when we were filming up there. They gave me my own room. And then I finally said, "Okay, it's my turn to come." So I decided I will take the end of 2003 off. I won't say yes to any projects. And I'll come to the Czech Republic. I mean, I knew where it was. I'd done my research, of course, but I was really surprised by what I saw. It was basically this time of year. It was the end of November. It was right around Thanksgiving, in fact. It was so gray. The sky was gray. The buildings, the Panalaki, which had not been painted, didn't have all these crazy designs and colors on them. They were gray. The streets were gray. The people's faces were gray. The clothes they wore, the trams were this ugly, horrible shade of yellow. It was awful. It was really depressing. So I didn't go straight to Prague. I got off the airplane. My wife and her sister came to pick me up. I love my sister-in-law, but she barely knew how to drive. We actually ended up going the wrong way on the highway for a split second coming out of the airport. Oh my God, this is how I'm going to die, in a small Škoda Favorit. It was really shocking. I didn't actually get to come to Prague until a few days later, but Pilsen was just awful. The first thing they did, obviously, the next day when I was, or actually, probably was the same day because I arrived in the morning. I remember we went to the brewery I remember the very old man who pours the beer out of big barrels at the end. As soon as my wife opened her mouth and spoke in Czech, oh, you're a Czech girl. We live in Slovenia. Oh, come on. So we stayed for an hour drinking beer, you know, jet lagged and everything. So, okay, this is getting a little bit better. So all this free beer from this nice, friendly old Czech man. I got a picture of him somewhere. Then Markéta took she took as much time off as she could. She'd already taken so much time off that year. But, you know, she took me to Prague. We ended up going down to a few other places. I would have to actually look at the picture to remember everywhere we went. But she really took the time to show me. She had to work. So I would basically leave on Monday morning, get on a train and go somewhere that I wanted to see. So I made it as far east as Spiski Hrad in Slovakia, which was bizarre because I didn't speak a word and they were not expecting any kind of tourists at that time of year, especially an American guy by himself. So I was the only person touring this UNESCO heritage site, you know, 2 days before Christmas. I made as many trips as I could. I made it up to Dresden. On the weekends, Markéta would join me. So she joined me in Bratislava for a weekend. You know, she joined me probably in Budějovice or somewhere like that for the weekend. But I was still traveling as much as I could, you know, during the week. There really wasn't much to do in Pilsen from Monday to Friday. As soon as I finished and I flew home, I knew two things. I sort of knew that what was happening with Markéta and I was very real. And I also knew I had no desire to live in the city of Pilsen. It was awful.
So how did it happen that you are actually living in Pilsen?
There I was home, you know, living alone again. So I decided at the end of 2004, okay, I'm going to go back to the Czech Republic and I'm going to ask her to marry me. I had come planning to go back to Los Angeles at the beginning of January. I had submitted all of my paperwork. When you want to make the jump into the Directors Guild of America, this is the DGA. As an assistant director, there's several ways you can get in, but they mostly involve massive amounts of paperwork. It took almost 3 months for them to verify all of my paperwork. And I didn't have anything else to do. And so as Christmas turned to New Year and New Year turned into the spring, I stayed. My wife, my fiance at the time, Slovenka, said, get a job, do something. So I started teaching at a little language school called Dům u Slunce, just a couple hours a week. Like, this is easy. I just sit and talk to people and they talk back, which I'm talking too much. You should be talking more. So I started doing that and I realized, like, this is a great little gig. I'm a natural at this. I like people. I engage with people. I like hearing stories and talking back. So I stayed for 6 months and it was a miracle that the weather changed. This horrible gray skies turned to beautiful spring and flowers bloomed and the temperature warmed. And then from spring came summer and clothes started coming off of people's bodies and smiles erupted on their faces and beer flowed and the gardens opened. And I thought, this is miraculous. What is this? And it's four seasons. When you grow up in Texas, there's two seasons. There's four seasons in one day. It's hot, cold, windy, snow. But in California, it's always spring. It's always summer. I had never seen fall. I had never seen winter. I had never seen this change. And it was mind-blowing. I fell in love with the country, with the seasons, because truthfully, where the Czech Republic is located, it's exactly where those seasons happen. So you can look at the calendar and know that on September 22nd, it's going to get windy and a little chilly and the leaves are going to be falling. It's a miracle to me. I really, really love it. So it's not the beer. It's not the girl. It's none of that. It's the weather. I fell in love with the Czech Republic because of the weather. The history is nice and the rivers and the forest, but no, the weather is fantastic.
Do you happen to have a favorite Czech movie?
I always forget the title. You have to help me out here. It's the movie where the girls, it's the Christmas film, the wives stay in Prague and the dads go up to the mountains with their kids and they take them skiing. And they give them
svět.
That's my favorite film because it's got that horrible, wonderful song.
Sladké mami.
Yes. I still have not seen that film with subtitles. I speak Czech horribly. I apologize profusely. I've had 17 years to learn the language. I've learned enough to go to the pub and get out of a traffic ticket and order at a restaurant, but I am not conversational nowhere close to like some of my friends. They've really worked hard, and I appreciate the work it takes. So I watch that. I see that movie every year. I still don't understand every joke. I still don't understand every word. But the whole concept of the film is absolutely fabulous. You know, yeah, dads are going to take the kids, and what a disaster that turns out to be. And boy, look what the moms are doing back home in Prague, dancing their heads off. What? Nice film. Still my favorite to watch.
So I'm guessing you know both sides of the USA in the way that you have been living in Texas, which is a Republican kind of place. And then you
not
have
so
been,
much anymore.
Not so much anymore, right? But you know, in the times when you have been living there, probably it was. And then you have been living in LA, which is more of a place of Democrats, let's say. So sure. Which of those two groups do you assume that would be more happy living in the Czech Republic?
I would guess that the majority of people on the left would welcome living in Europe and the Czech Republic specifically, because it checks a lot of the boxes. Nationalized healthcare, you lose your job, you don't lose your healthcare. You lose your job and unemployment, no problem. I mean, it's there's a lot of that safety net that we talk about, which is still a long running dream in the United States. That hasn't quite come yet and maybe never will. So people on the left would really enjoy living in Europe for all of those benefits. And there's much more equality. I mean, the thing that really needs to be emphasized about the United States, it is at historic levels of inequality. The Jeff Bezos, I love him. I mean, Amazon is an amazing company. I remember when I was selling books, but he's the richest man on the planet and probably the richest man in the history of the planet. More than any king, queen, pharaoh, it's just phenomenal how much money he has. And it's wrong. So I think the biggest problem that the planet faces, along with global warming and COVID and every other problem, is it's out of whack, especially in the West. There's problems in Europe as well. There's problems here. I mean, we've got billionaires. They're becoming bigger and bigger billionaires while other people haven't seen any real change in their circumstance. So that inequality is really the biggest problem. And it's so huge in the United States. And there's but most Americans are living in a dream. They imagine that they will be a millionaire, or you know, if they scratch a ticket, or if they work a little bit harder, take a second job, or have a great idea. And it's just not true. It's just not true. That wealth protects itself and insulates itself. And unless you really get on one of those tracks, yeah, you might get lucky. People are self-made. That happens every year, every day. But the vast majority of Americans who are born into poverty will stay in poverty. The concentration of wealth in America is at critical and catastrophic levels. In Europe, you have a much better system of taxes to sort of close that gap a little bit. It's better in Denmark. It's better in Sweden, in Norway, and those countries, the Nordic countries. But overall, Europe does a much better job of this.
Well, it's always a pleasure to have a chit-chat with a foreigner living not in Prague, but in Pilsen. So could you maybe share a bit of your experience? I'm sure that the first experience weren't that great in the early 2000s, but now I hope that the life of expats is better. So is it?
Absolutely. When you come to a city the size of Pilsen, and I, again, chose to come to a city the size of Pilsen because I wanted to be in a smaller city, it takes a very short amount of time before you start to see the same person a second time and a third time. You really build relationships quite quickly. I don't know that that's true in Prague. I used to joke about the first time I was in my car in Los Angeles and I looked over to the next car and it was somebody I knew. That was an amazing moment. I mean, within the first few weeks of living in Pilsen, I was seeing people I knew waiting for the tram, walking down the street. It is a village. And I know that one of my very close friends, Paul Venturo, he was dating my sister-in-law for many, many years. They moved to Prague together. And Paul has made an amazing circle of friends, but it's a lot of other expatriates as well. That's true for me. I would say the majority of my friends are other expats. It's, you know, a French guy, a lot of Mexican guys. There's a lot of Mexicans living in the Czech Republic now, which was a bit of a surprise mostly because of the automotive industry. When they started moving the automobile factories from Detroit down to Mexico in the 90s, this gave birth to an automotive industry in Mexico, and you're seeing your first and second generation of automotive engineers branching out into the world. So I've got friends working for Volkswagen and Honeywell, and you know, the people who put the steering column in your Fiat. And so it's pretty amazing, that kind of globalism. And that's here in Pilsen as well. So there's lots of foreigners living here now. We don't gather, we don't meet, but I think one of the benefits of living in Pilsen was I also have a pretty good variety of Czech friends as well. Guys I met through American football, you know, guys I met, I'm good friends with the two guys who started the pub franchise. I think that's one of the great benefits of living in Pilsen compared to Prague. It's less transitory as well. I know that people come into Prague, they work for a few years and they leave again, especially foreigners. Here, most of these guys have come and they've stayed. A few guys have come, left, come back, left, and they're back again. So there's something magical about that. And that's part of living in a small town. So Pilsen is not a small town anymore. There's lots of international companies. There's better rail connections. I wish we had an airport, but I guess Prague's not that far away. You still have to go to Prague if you really want to go see Madonna or the Foo Fighters. They're not going to come to Pilsen necessarily. I make it to Ostrava every year for the Colors Festival. That's my big thing. So I still don't know that I would have been happier living in Prague. It's hard to say. It's a beautiful city. That's where all the action is in some ways. I'm really happy to see other cities really kind of developing as well. And, you know, we ended up in České Budějovice a couple of times this summer for various things, for baseball. My daughter plays baseball, and it's a great town. It's really come a long ways too. So I used to think that West Bohemia was so far behind what goes on in Bavaria. That's not true anymore. You know, we may never quite catch up to the German level of life, but I also wouldn't trade the kind of freedoms that we have here, the kind of stuff they have to go through, just where they put their trash can and, you know, got to keep the car parked on the right way, whatever. So that kind of uniformity and conformity doesn't really jibe with me. I really like those kind of freedoms that we enjoy in the Czech Republic, to be a little more loose, a little more casual, a little more relaxed. That goes double for a city like Pilsen. You can really kind of let your hair down here.
So I have just the final question. With the upcoming season, I have to ask you, who brings presents to your home? Is it Santa or Ježíšek?
My daughter, who is going to be 10 in February of next year, I'm a little surprised. She's still full in on the whole process. She put a letter on the window for Ježíšek. It disappeared during the night. Mine did not, by the way. I also had a letter out there asking for a daughter who makes her bed, who listens to her mother and does all her homework like she's supposed to. Ježíšek did not pick up my letter. It was really frustrating. It was still taped there the next day, but he took hers. No, she has enjoyed a pretty equally split lifestyle. She watches all of the Disney films in English, and she watches all of the Czech fairy tales in Czech. She has been to the United States multiple times. She has obviously traveled all over the Czech Republic as well. We've taken her all over the world, you know, to China and the Philippines and Malaysia and places like this. So she's quite international for her age. But when it comes to Christmas, she has always had both. So Ježíšek comes, you know, sometime in the late afternoon, early evening of the 24th, and there's tons of stuff under the tree. And the next morning when she wakes up on Christmas Day, for us in the States, there's usually at least one more present directly addressed to her from Santa Claus.
Okay, great. So thank you so much for being here as my guest, and I hope that you will see a lot of funny Czech movies during the Christmas season.
I will probably see the same ones that are on every single stinking year. Unfortunately, I already know how the Schmutna Princessa finishes, which is also a great one too. No, it's going to be, unfortunately, because of COVID, I think a lot of people are going to be a little tired of watching television this year, but the classics are still the classics, and we're looking forward to the holidays. So I hope you have a very happy holiday too.
Thank you. I wish you a happy holiday too, and I wish a happy holiday to our listeners as well. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Katka. Bye.